Hi, welcome to Beacon Hill Update on Frontier Community Access Television. Today, part two of my two-part conversation with Senate President Stan Rosenberg. And in the first discussion, we talked a lot about the pipeline. So we'll declare this a pipeline-free zone for now, because there's many other things to talk about. The rising cost of education, I'm talking about higher education now, yep, in Massachusetts, is staggering. Anybody who's going to college now is coming out with huge loans that they have to repay, and the jobs and the economy, the salaries just aren't there to be able to support it. There's something called the RISE Act you're working on. Let's talk about what the RISE Act is.
So the RISE Act is the Senate's approach to discussing the future of public education, K through 12. There's separate conversations going on pre-K, in part through our Kids First initiative in the Senate, and then also with regard to public higher education and higher education in general, which is also part of the Kids First initiative and discussion, and also our economic development discussions. But to focus specifically on the RISE Act, we're talking about K through 12.
Okay, so it is K through 12.
It is K through 12, and what the issue, we moved into this conversation because of a ballot question to increase the number of charter schools, Commonwealth charter schools, which operate outside of the public school, traditional public school systems, but are funded with public funds. And as we know, there's been lots of concern in our region because there are only a few charter schools. They're very good charter schools, but they the money follows the child out of the school into the charter school. And given the size of school budgets and a whole series of other things, it really stresses traditional public schools. And when charter schools were started in the Commonwealth, it was for two purposes. One, to give children a place to go to from public schools that were failing. And the second was to create more innovation in education. And so they now have this tiered system of labeling you from level one to level five, and most of our schools are levels one and two, fair number level three, and very few on four and five. And four and five is where you would want charter schools, Commonwealth charter schools, if you were saying that children need to be able to get out of schools that are not performing
well.
Right,
you would expect it to be four and
five. And there are very few of those around. And yet there's still momentum to build and open more charter schools. And so there's this ballot question, which is going to increase the number of charter schools, if it's approved by the voters, up to 12 new charter schools a year in districts that are not four and five. Districts that are four and five, unlimited number of new charter schools, not against the cap. So that means it could be a huge number of new charter schools. So we've started a conversation debate in the legislature. Should we be authorizing more Commonwealth charters, and where and under what conditions and how many? And about 18 months ago, the Senate turned down an increase for more charter schools because of the funding mechanism, because of certain uneven practices among charter schools for admissions, retention, selection, all of those sorts of things. So what the RISE Act does is it says, what do we need to do for all children, whether in the Commonwealth charters or traditional public schools? And it says, we're going to increase funding in public education consistent with the Foundation Review Commission's recommendations over a 7-year period. And we're going to tie the creation of new innovation seats, Commonwealth charters, yeah, Horace Mann charters, and innovation schools, to the increase in funding. And so it would be proportionate. If we fully fund this year's installment, then you get the maximum number of seats this year. If we only can do half, then you get half as many new seats.
So it's a gradual approach, consistent with funding, rather than just opening the floodgates.
Correct. And then the second thing is to do reforms within the charter school movement based on the best practices, mostly within the charters themselves, but also some consistent with the traditional public schools. So for example, in a traditional public school, you expect all teachers to be certified. In charter schools, they don't have to be.
Right.
So that speaks to quality and goes to quality. And so the bill, for example, says that teachers in charter schools as we hire new teachers should be certified. So things of that nature. So it's a comprehensive approach on both the funding and the policy side relating to future public education, including all forms of innovation seats, from the Commonwealth charters to the Horace Mann charters to the innovation schools. So we got 22 votes for that. Yeah, was it 22 or 24? I'm pretty sure it was 22 votes. And the last charter bill that was, the previous charter bill that was on the floor about 18 months ago got 13 votes, and two of those senators had left. Mm. So there were only 11 senators who were kind of open to this. And so we had to get from 11 to 21. And in order to do that, we had to shift the paradigm and shift the conversation away from just talking about charter schools and children in charter schools to the broader needs of public education. We put in this bill Superintendent Bonacondi's idea of what he called sparsity aid to help the smaller school districts. We put in some other pieces that would assist various school districts that would have problems sustaining themselves because of the drop in enrollment, both because of population and demographics, but also because of children migrating out of their school systems, either through school choice or through charters.
Along with the idea of sort of leveling the playing field and keeping the charter thing in line with available funding is an idea that is being proposed for a constitutional amendment that would change the way Massachusetts taxes people who make over $1 million a year.
Correct.
It's a 5% surcharge beginning with $1 over $1 million in earnings. And it has to pass two constitutional conventions. But what's interesting about that is it's specifically, the money would be specifically earmarked for two purposes, transportation and education.
And education, right.
If this passes and it goes through, is that going to be, will that mark the end of the funding problems, or will it just help?
Okay, let me just do one small correction just to make sure it's clear. The first million is 5%.
5%.
Every dollar over the million is another 4%.
Well, 4%, okay.
Okay. So I just want to make sure that's clear for all of us, that we're only talking about the from $1 million up. Is the
extra
4%. Right. Okay, and it would be totally earmarked for education and transportation. So the Foundation Review Commission's recommendations would cost about $1.4 billion. Higher education needs another $700 million to bring down the cost to students and have adequate financial aid so that all unmet financial aid needs are met. And we need between another 140 and 400 million for early childhood education for income eligible kids, based upon the whether you want to just get a kid in a seat or whether you want to ensure the highest quality for every seat. So that's why it's between 140 and 400 million. So a billion and a half coming out of that new tax for education wouldn't cover everything, but it would go a huge way toward covering it. And you would expect that education would still get some portion of the growth revenues from our basic tax structure. So if we were able to pass that tax structure, I believe we would be able to, over a reasonable period of time, invest in the transportation that everybody wants, to have a world-class transportation system so that we can support our economy. And we would also have enough money to, between that new revenue source and the existing revenue stream, to be able to have a really solid path forward to fund our education needs.
It's a tough beat, though, because you've tried to do this before and it's never really been anything that anybody's wanted to tackle.
Yeah, that's why this is structured totally differently. The previous ones were just changing the language to say you could have a graduated income tax. This one says, how much, who's going to pay, how much, and what's the money going to be used for? And it can't be changed by the legislature without going back to the people, because it's a constitutional amendment.
Well, I know that the legislature tried to index inflation, the gas tax, the rate of inflation, and that got defeated by the voters. I wonder if the fact that this is specifically earmarked for two very important things makes a difference in the conversation.
We hope it will. And gas taxes are very unpopular, and they're easily demagogued.
Yeah,
so,
but even when the price is now down to just over $2, where it was up around $4, you know, not that long ago.
Had we, you know, the old system, it was a percentage as opposed to a fixed number of cents per gallon.
Right.
If we had left the percentage in place and put all that money in the in a transportation trust fund and just used it for transportation, we'd have a world-class system right now. And we wouldn't be talking about these shocks, meaning increasing, because, you know, when you go to pull up to the pump, you're going to fill it no matter whether it's $1.90 or $2.90, because you got to get the gas.
Yeah.
And we can mutter under our breaths while we're doing it, that money's going to the companies that produce the gas, that distribute the gas, that sell the gas, etc. You know, only when you have a choice as to whether or not you'll pay the tax, do you have a chance to really strike out lash out at the people who are doing that to you. So I get it. But, you know, I mean, the reality is we were talking really pennies on the gallon, not dollars on the gallon.
Right.
And we're already seeing, what, a 30, 40 cent increase in the last 5 or 6 weeks.
Yeah, it went up, and it seems like it goes up a lot faster than it comes down, although it did come down to below $2 for a while.
Oh, it was fantastic. I mean, with my little card, I was getting, I actually at one point was very excited because I was filling up at $1.80.
Yeah.
And I was like, wow, this is good. But and now we're back up to $2.20. We just filled up this morning, $2.23.
It's funny when the gas prices go up, everybody blames the president, but when they come back down, nobody thanks the president.
Nobody thanks him. You're right.
I always find that pretty funny.
Oh, the trials and tribulations of being in politics.
Yeah. I want to go back to the education thing and go back to the original question I asked, which was the price of higher ed. And I know that UMass this year didn't get cut, but it didn't get nearly the amount of money it needed to get.
Yeah.
And the price of going to college, because to make up that difference, colleges have to raise fees and tuition. So it makes it that much tougher for people, and it prices some people completely out. And I know, because my wife is still going to school, and I know that it's much more expensive than it was even when I went 20 years ago. So what can the legislature, or is the legislature doing to try and reduce that burden?
So we're all working within the same revenue figures, the governor, the House, and the Senate. And the governor gave a very modest increase, I don't think the House gave 1%, and so it's now our turn, and I'm hoping we can push the envelope and go as high as we possibly can because of this problem with student debt. But we're not going to see a huge increase because the money just simply isn't there.
Right.
So again, the Fair Share Plan is something that offers some hope. We're working with the colleges and universities, and they're working really hard at trying to squeeze their own costs to bring costs down. Part of the high cost of going to our public college and universities in Massachusetts is because in recent years they've had to pay for half or more of the buildings that they've been building, which normally in the past the Commonwealth paid 100% of. We've started to squeeze that dramatically and increase the amount the state's contributing, like the up here at GCC.
Yeah.
That building, I think, was totally paid. The addition was totally paid for by the Commonwealth, not by the students there. So we're trying to come up with strategies to try to help bring the cost down. But ultimately, it's a matter of having adequate state appropriations. In order to do that, we need adequate revenues.
But there's no plans to try and raise taxes at this point for that kind of thing.
The governor said no new taxes for his entire 4 years, and the speaker said no new taxes in last year's budget. He said that again a couple of months ago for this year. All taxes originate in the House. They don't originate in the Senate. We are not allowed to under the Constitution.
Is that a realistic thing to say, though? I mean, can you really say that that's the best way to go, to just say we're never going to raise taxes in 4 years? I mean, it doesn't seem like that's realistic.
I would not recommend that to any candidate that I was advising.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, the list of candidates that get elected advocating, well, I look at Walter Mondale and you know what happened to him. That was a long time ago.
Well, it's really interesting because in speaking about that with regard to Governor Baker, he set out the goal of increasing local aid, including public education, at the same percentage increase in the growth of revenue. That was 4.3% this year. For the public schools, I think he hit 1.6%. Wow. So even his own ambitions and aspirations for the schools, he was unable to do.
Well, it's different when you're running than when you get in. I mean, once you get in and take a look at the real numbers, you're like, well, I can't do this, I can't do that.
Can't do that, right.
It becomes a question of more what you can't do than what you can do, unfortunately.
Unfortunately, and with 42% of the budget going to healthcare and, you know, some other cost centers that keep growing, that you have no choice, you have to pay those first. It's challenging.
As a public policy professional, and I want to talk about the presidential campaign just for a second, because one of the things that Bernie Sanders has made a lot of hay with is the idea of making college free and using that the money from a tax, or actually a tax on Wall Street speculation, which is a nice soundbite, but is it realistic to think that there could come a day when Massachusetts kids could go to college for free?
Well, I think if you asked this question 200 years ago about people going to public schools, they might have had the same question, but we eventually found a way to get kids into public schools for 12 years, quote, free. And there's no such thing as free. Somebody is paying, but it's the taxpayer. Could we eventually see at least 2 years of college, quote, free or virtually free? Yeah, California did it, but they aren't able to do it anymore.
Well, their economy's in the current,
in
trouble.
In the current environment. So, if you're going to set that as a priority and a social goal for your commonwealth or for your state or for the country, you have to figure out a way to pay for it and convince the people that this investment is worth doing, making. And it surely took a while, but we now have free public education for everyone in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts in our public schools.
Let's turn to energy, which we touched on briefly in the first show, but I want to get back to the solar issue and the idea of solar net metering and the battle that went on over that.
It's not over.
I don't think it's ever going to be over.
No, it's not over.
But a group like Environment Massachusetts wants to see within, I think, 10 years, wants to see 20 to 25% of the energy from the state come from the sun. Is that at all a realistic possibility? Could there be a time we could see double-digit power generation by the sun?
So the answer is, if we decide we want to do it, we can do it. We set out, before the bottle bill, we had almost no recycling. With the bottle bill, we went up to a whole 10%. And then after the bottle bill legislation was passed, we're now in the 40% range. People back then would have thought, never, that's never going to happen. Well, and when we started with solar energy about 6 or 7 years ago, very few people had solar on their roofs or at their businesses. And now we are the leading state in the country. We have a significant number of megawatts being produced by solar, and that's only going to grow. How quickly and to what number, can't say, but our goal should be to green our energy supply so that we have as close to 100% being produced through green technology, wind, solar, geothermal, hydro, all big and small, within the next 20 or 30 years. And some people say if we really focused and did it right, we could do it within 15 years. When you think about the fact that we're at the, quote, end of the pipeline, I don't mean pipeline.
Yeah.
I mean at the end of all energy systems, because we don't have natural resources to produce energy other than wood, and we're not going to cut our forests down again to, you know, heat our homes and run our businesses with wood the way it was done 150 and 200 years ago. But basically, we're in a situation where we have the ability to transition and keep that money in the Commonwealth. Because right now, about 90% of our energy money is paid into a system that exports the money out of state.
Yeah.
And imagine if that 90% of those billions and billions of dollars that we're spending on energy stayed in the state and was circulating in our own economy, what that would do. And by the way, the same thing on food. The more food we produce here in Massachusetts, the more that money stays in our own economy as opposed to being brought in. And we still are bringing in about 85-90% of our food. We're importing it. And so those are dollars that are flowing out of the Commonwealth as opposed to here. So anything we can do locally, and you know, we're not talking about isolationism, we're talking about building systems within our own economy that allow us to produce and use our own products for our own benefit.
Well, it's not all that different from the local food movement. Organizations like CISA, that's what they preach.
That's exactly.
The stronger our farms are, the stronger our food supply is, mm-hmm. and the fresher it is, too.
Right.
And so it's a variation on a common theme. But since you opened the door to recycling, there seems like there's an effort to try and eviscerate the bottle bill, to make it go away, essentially, just to shift it from a five-cent return to 1 cent for 1 year and then have it go away. Does that have any legs at all?
I don't believe it has legs this term, but a number of states have reviewed their existing bottle laws. Very few states have bottle laws, and a few of them have actually eliminated them already in favor of what they call a single-stream system,
right,
as opposed to having a bifurcated system where you take part of it back to the store and you put part of it in your recycling bucket, either at the curb or when you deliver it to the landfill or recycling center. So, some states are reviewing and revising. This is a very it's a very emotional issue for a lot of people,
yeah,
because they worked so hard to get it, and we were one of the first bottle laws in the country, and it took 14 years, I think, to get it on the books, and we doubled recycling overnight, reduced litter, and so all of the benefits that people saw. But this was, of course, before we had municipal recycling systems.
Yeah.
And now economists and others are looking at it saying, well, there is a cost to having duplicate systems. There's nothing wrong with doing it if you want to keep doing it that way, but it's not as economically efficient as if you were to switch to a single stream system.
Well, the single stream argument's one that's also being advanced by the bottle companies, the soda companies,
yes,
and the grocery companies,
yeah,
as sort of a neat way to sort of push the issue. But I can't imagine a democratically controlled legislature eviscerating that bottle bill. I just don't see it happening.
The voters turned expansion of the bottle bill down. So expansion.
That's the opening, right?
That's where the opening came from. So you're not going to see a push to expand the bottle bill at this time. But while we have that hiatus from that conversation, folks who would like to shift to a single stream system are taking advantage of the opening that creates to see if over a few years' time they can convince people to make a shift.
Okay, we only have a few minutes left, and I can't let you leave without talking about Rattlesnake Island.
Rattlesnake Island.
There's an idea of putting timber rattlesnakes on an island in the middle of the Quabbin Reservoir. People in the North Quabbin, it doesn't necessarily affect our towns, but anybody who goes to the Quabbin and recreates there and likes to hike, the fear is the snakes are going to jump in the water, swim across, and bite people. And I know that you've been taking a lot of calls about this. And I don't mean to laugh because I know it's very serious to some people, but it seems kind of ludicrous that this would be the political bombshell that it's become. But what are your thoughts on Rattlesnake?
You just never know. So there are a couple of things going on here. The first is this was a project federally funded under the Patrick administration. They started working on it, and it carried over into the Baker administration, and now they're at the implementation stage. And what I've said publicly on this is a few things. The first is that I think the big mistake is that there was too little transparency and public engagement and which left open the possibility that people could react emotionally,
yeah,
and express legitimate concerns, but not in a forum and in a format and a way that allowed for getting some answers and some responses before people get really worked up about it. And I said in Boston to a group of people in Western Mass who were there last week that, the way I think about this is because there was so little transparency and little preparation for the public, when I heard about it, I'm like, oh, rattlesnakes, that's gun smoke. And I never saw a good meeting between a cowboy and a rattlesnake. It always ended badly, and usually with a rifle shooting the head off the snake. And so I'm like, okay, what do we know about this? What we know is what we've heard, and the scientists say what you've heard is or what you think you know is not the way it works. That said, We're going to have a public hearing very soon. I think it's next week or the week after. And we're going to gather public testimony. We're going to gather information. We're going to have some scientists. We're going to have some people talk about this and put some of the stuff on the table that should have been put on the table a lot earlier. And some of the initial reaction that I've heard is, you know, well, if we need to regenerate this species here in Massachusetts, where are the best places to do it, et cetera? We just learned that there's already at least two sites that have already been started before the public even knew.
Oh, really?
Yes.
So there's already a snake movement.
There's already snake movement. And about the swimming, they do love to swim, apparently. Oh, and we've seen video on that. So at a St. Patrick's Day roast, I said to the governor, he stood up and as part of his roast, because the criticism had just started about the rattlesnakes, he made some joke about it. And when he got up, I said, that's my district you're talking about, Governor, and I'm filing legislation tomorrow. So because I learned that they love to swim. And Swampscott has lots of water. I'm filing legislation tomorrow that we're going to, instead of doing it on the island in the Quabbin, we're going to do it in Swampscott.
That's excellent. I'm sure he'd love that. Although I would suggest that one amendment...
He took it in the spirit in which it was intended.
Of course, he would have to. But I think one amendment you should consider if that bill does come before the legislature is to rename the island Trump Island. I think that would probably work. I know we had to get Trump in there somewhere because it's a political discussion.
Oh my God, that's
it'd be huge. In any event, so is this going to happen? I mean, or are you just going to have?
Well, it doesn't require legislative approval.
Oh, it doesn't.
That said, you know, the legislature could speak to it, but let's see what the hearing produces and where we go from there.
All right. Well, good enough, Senator Rosenberg. I know tonight, as we're taping this, you have a fundraiser in Turner's Falls. I guess. Why does a guy like you have to raise funds? You're not going to have an opponent.
Oh, I do have an opponent.
You do?
Yes.
Oh, actually, you know what? I saw that guy.
Yeah.
It was a guy out in front of Big Y collecting signatures. On the back of his clipboard, it said, no more taxes. He wouldn't give me his name, though. He wanted my signature, but he wouldn't give me his name. I didn't sign the thing.
So usually you don't give your opponent's name, but... his name is Peltier, P-E-L-T-I-E-R.
Okay.
And his claim to fame is he was on the Diane Sawyer show where he was explaining his setting up two websites, one a democratic-something.org and the other republican-something.org and took contributions on those two websites.
I'm going to have the guy in here.
Assuming you're going to have to find
him,
out.
I'll have to like scour the
South Hadley. He's in South Hadley.
Well, in any event, good luck on that.
Thank you.
I'm sure you'll bring it, rake in lots of money, which you need, I'm sure, to bite back this vicious challenge.
It's part of our business.
Senate President Stan Rosenberg, thanks for making the time, always. It's always good to have you in here to get the skinny on what's happened under the Golden Dome. And we'll have you in again sometime, I'm sure. Thanks
Thank
a lot.
Thank you very much.
Senate President Stan Rosenberg has been my guest. That is Beacon Hill Update. I am Chris Collins. Thanks for watching FCAT. And for all of us here, have a good day.